Dedicated to the lover.
To the lover.
In you.
All right, now DJ Roz got us jamming tonight. Y'all ready? Y'all ready? Now we're here.
Leather in the summer, silk in the winter. This is such an art. Where do I begin?
All right. It is 7:35, and we still got a few more people trickling in, but we definitely want to be respectful of everybody's time. We want to thank you guys for joining us tonight. This is not the first time that we've done this. We've done this before, and we're going to be doing it again. So we thank y'all for those of you who were with us in the past and who have been tuning in, who are with us back again. We thank y'all. And for those of this is your first time, we welcome you. We welcome you to the family, to the conversation. And we want to make sure that we're being a resource for you all so that you're getting the information that you need to learn about what's going on in the state of Virginia, where most of you guys are residing. So tonight is the Virginia Town Hall. This is Fighting for Cannabis Social Equity and Economic Opportunities for Disadvantaged Business Enterprises. So that's what we're talking about tonight, right? We want to make sure that as Virginia is coming online, joining a number of states around the country that have legalized for adult use cannabis, that we're doing this in a way that opens up the doors for minority business enterprises, as well as disadvantaged business enterprises, and those individuals who come from those communities that really bore the brunt of the war on drugs. And so we're gonna get into it tonight. My name is Eric Range. I am the board chair for Minorities for Medical Marijuana. We're a national 501c3 nonprofit organization with chapters in 27 states around the country, including Virginia. And we have been at the forefront of making sure that public policy, again, is written with a focus of social justice and social economics. We're moving, you know, to that term of social economics, if you will. So we're fighting in the policy front. We're also educating communities about what's happening in this industry, access points, and about the medical benefits of the plant and so much more. But we got an esteemed, and I'm going to be serving as your moderator tonight. So you guys didn't come to hear me talk. You came to hear our esteemed panelists talk. And they have quite a bit to tell y'all. So we're going to get to it. And I want to introduce them and then give them a few moments to introduce themselves to you all as well. But tonight we're going to be joined by Antoine Hines, who is the Virginia State Chapter President. And Antoine's going to come to us and tell us a little bit about himself in just a few moments now. And we're also going to be joined by Ms. Charlene Maureen, who is a cannabis attorney there in Virginia. And of course, this town hall is done in partnership with Marijuana Justice. And of course, we have none other than the executive director, Ms. Chelsea Higgs-Wise, the director of Marijuana Justice, joining us tonight. And so we're gonna go around and just give each of our moderators a few moments to introduce themselves. Now, I started by introducing Antoine, but I'm gonna go backwards and start with the ladies. And Chelsea, please come off and tell the crowd, the audience, who you are. I know most people in the room probably know who you are, but for those who don't, please.
Thank you so much, Eric, for that introduction. And I'm always excited to meet new people, particularly in the Commonwealth space and this cannabis space. So again, my name is Chelsea Higgs-Wise. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. And I'm a longtime resident of the Richmond, Virginia area. I'm a mother, I am a sister, I'm a daughter, and I'm just really excited to also be the co-founder of Marijuana Justice. And our mission is to really organize a gateway to dismantle the war on drugs through equitable legalization. And so that's really what our mission is. And we've been in formation since 2019, learning from groups like Minorities for Medical Marijuana and other leaders that have been doing this for years, just realizing there was a gap in Virginia. And so we are still really connecting to people like Charlene, to Antoine, and been working for years. So I'm really excited to be here to continue to grow, particularly after this last General Assembly session. So I'm just so pleased to be here and welcome everyone.
Thank you for being here with us. And we're gonna get into it. And I was seeing if she was gonna start to go right into it. So I'm glad that she's gonna let us get to it in just a second. All right. Charlene, please go ahead and introduce yourself to the audience.
Oh, well, thank you, Eric, and thank you, Chelsea, Antoine, and Taraz, to Minorities for Medical Marijuana, for allowing me this platform tonight to talk to all of you. My name is Charlene Morin. I am the owner, principal owner of the law firm of Charlene Morin in Norfolk. I have two offices, one in Norfolk and one in Newport News. I've been practicing law for about 20 plus years, licensed in Virginia, North Carolina. But more importantly, I am a community advocate. And so I kind of stumbled in this space because I'm huge on community. And when I say community, I mean community, about ensuring that we're educated and that we have the hits that are for us and for our communities, and particularly in this space where I see so many things, whether it be economic and or the way the criminal system has been set up or is trying to be set up. And so there are various reasons why we need to be educated as this new cannabis industry comes into the area. And so I took on a challenge, and I'm just humbled to be here today and to talk to you all.
Absolutely. Again, thank you for being with us. And then, of course, Antoine, my brother, talk to us,
what
man.
What up? This is awesome. This is what we're doing. This is what we're taking care of. It's time to move the pillar, move the wall, break it down, Black power, all of it. So I'm here. I'm excited. I love this. I love Minorities Medical Marijuana. I love marijuana justice. I love new people. Thank you for coming on board. Everyone inside the room, thank you for joining us for this Virginia Town Hall with us tonight. We did it before. We're going to do it again, and we're going to keep on doing it because we can't stop. Because there's people who are still in prison right now. There are still people who are getting taken to jail right now. There are people who don't have their rights right now. There are people who are making billions of dollars off of the same thing those people are in jail right now. So I'm just here.
Hey, listen, I'm sitting here and I'm laughing because y'all see the energy, right? This is who represents Minorities for Medical Marijuana in Virginia, right? This is the type of energy that we bring to the table, the type of passion about fighting for you all. And all the while, you guys didn't even hear him mention that he was a veteran. All right. Yep. And that he served our country. We should be thanking him, and yet he's still fighting for it. So, brother, I'm going to say it to you right off bat. Thank you. And to any other veterans in the room, thank you all for your service, for your sacrifice. We appreciate y'all. We love y'all. And Antoine, we're glad that you're still here fighting this fight for us.
No problem.
Yeah. So I'm excited, man. You know, listen, so it's crazy how fast time flies, right? The last time we were on, this was right after July 1st.
Yep.
You know, things that had just popped off in the state. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody was super excited, and it happens, right? Like, I know mm-hmm. this, but then, you know, things kick in and the process starts to slow down a little bit, right? That excitement starts to get into the actual sausage making, as they say, mm-hmm. you know,
the process
when it comes to politics, right? And that can be a tough process. So Antoine, talk to us a little bit about, and actually I'll open this up to any one of you guys. Talk to us a little bit about July 1 to now. You know, what have we seen? And again, I know we're going to talk a little bit about what happened in session lately. But even before session, you know, there was a lot of movement, a lot of activism going on, a lot that was taking place. So speak to what was taking place from July 1 up until now.
I'm gonna pass that over to Chelsea.
Okay, go ahead, Chelsea.
You know, honestly, I really appreciate Antoine's energy, and I appreciate passing the mic to me, but really everything that happened July 1 that everyone was so excited about couldn't be done without everyone. And since then, just some nitty gritty about it, the legislators have actually been meeting every month to look over that sausage making that Eric mentioned. And it's the Cannabis Control the Cannabis Oversight Commission. And it's made up of a body of legislators that have an interest within cannabis legislation from both sides of chambers, both sides of the party. And they've been the ones to make recommendations that brought us up to this past session. So that's what the legislators have been doing. You know, community advocates have been meeting monthly, as well as meeting with other stakeholders. We've been gathering data and really asking questions. How do you feel since July 1? You know, meeting with people like Sarah over at their business Lock Green and hearing about how they're trying to keep people safe, just different ideas of how to handle July 1. And even our coalition, Canada Justice, we held a virtual conference in December, canadajustice.org. We had 18 sessions, over 30 speakers to cover everything from seed to sale to really liberation to reparations, what I said as well. So we're really excited about all the movement that has gone into that. But I also just want to say that, you know, people have been reaching out, learning more and asking questions. So that's just one part about it. And I'd love to also just hear from Charlene and what it looked like from her side after July 1 and leading up to now.
A lot of pot questions. I think from the legal perspective, a lot of what I saw was twofold. What can I do? What can I grow? What does home cultivation really look like? And so when I spoke at South CanaCon, that was one of the things that we delved into. What's the difference between a seed? You know, can I go and share seeds? Can I go and, you know, give this, you know, pot plant that I have to my neighbor? And I got questions from, can I just buy a piece of land and just grow it and we all share the crop? So there's a lot of confusion, I think, from the perspective of just the resident, the July 1 resident that wants to now grow their pot, right? And how do they do it? So that was that. And then, like you said, Chelsea, a lot of advocacy on educating. Lock Green has done a really good job, as you stated, Sarah and her husband, and ensuring that we're keeping it safe. But there's a lot of questions across the board from what July 1 meant. And a lot of those questions come from those who say, okay, now I can have this. Well, what about that marijuana conviction that I got? So a lot of those questions have really been, I've gotten tons and tons of those questions. I'm sure we'll get into that. But for me, that's where the space has been. And then lastly, a lot of inquiries on the economic piece and what that looks like. Because even though they have the commission that's kind of looking at it, they still have the Cannabis Advisory Board. And they're still moving forward. There was a reenactment clause, but that reenactment clause was just for some pieces of it. So we know cannabis is coming and retail sales are coming to some extent. So what does that look like and how is that going to change? So those are mainly the questions that I've gotten.
Yeah, I mean, and you touched on three areas that I definitely want us to cover at some point in here: homegrown, expungements, and then licensing, right? Like I think a lot of people who are on this call, those are three areas that I think we can agree are pretty high on people's want to know list, right? You know, but before we even get there, you guys, you know, last election had some significant changes in the makeup of your legislature, you know, in terms of, you know, right now you guys have a Senate that is pretty, you know, responsive and getting things done. But your House has been pretty, you know, pretty tough to get through. And so can you talk about how that has, you know, like you said, they're meeting every week. So obviously there's conversations happening, but how have those conversations, I guess, been impacted by now the makeup of the legislature?
Yeah, I'm gonna jump in on here and just kind of bring up the difference between the bill that we passed in 2021 and the bill that was proposed this year. And the stark differences are because of that makeup that you mentioned. In 2021, Virginia had a Democratic governor, a Democratic House, a Democratic Senate. And after this election, the only thing that's left is a Democratic Senate by one vote majority. And if you don't know about the Senate rules, the tiebreaker is by the Lieutenant Governor, who is also a Republican. She is a Black woman, but she is a conservative with her views. And so that type of power difference definitely showed. So it appeared that, even what came out of the Senate, the same patron that passed a really good bill in 2021 that had social equity applications out early, that really allowed for a fund that had seed money for social equity operators, day one equity, no new crimes, a bill that looked like something that we really wanted and fought hard for. And then a lot of those pieces were jumbled apart and maybe still there, but the timelines made them really skeptical. And that, when we asked about that, when we said, hey, we see what's happening when you meet every month and the things are changing, timelines are changing. And they said, well, now there's a different different people in power. And so we want to make a compromise. And what we just saw was this compromise to the things that were important to Black folks, Black communities, Black voters, and Black entrepreneurs. And we really just started to be concerned. And so this is stark differences is the House really was very much like they did not even hear a bill, like literally had experts come in and say cannabis is not healthy and then didn't hear it before a crossover. So just really resistant in any conversations, y'all. But then from the Senate side, what they did propose was not something that centered us at all. So when people asked me, it really was a lose-lose situation. And there's been a lot of press and conversation on what the House did. But I think it's really important to show that when there was not an option for us on the table, right? That's really what I want people to know about what happened just now. And the reason go ahead.
Yeah, and I know just in doing my own research and brushing up on knowledge for tonight, you know, all of the articles that you find out there are painting such a rosy picture. Hey, the Senate passed, you know, this and so on. It's almost like what we say at the federal level, you know, the House will pass something, but it can't get through the Senate. And, you know, again, that's that sausage making that nobody likes. It is not fun. But I would tell you, from our organization's perspective, this is why we recognized very early on that we had to build an organization that was going to be sustainable and long term, because this was going to be an ongoing conversation, an ongoing, fight to get change. I mean, in my own home state of Florida, everything has been incremental. We passed our medical marijuana bill. And then, you know, we haven't been able to amend or change it because of the same type of, the political makeup, you know, doesn't allow for things to either get committed, or they get into a committee, they don't get heard, they don't get moved through. So, I know that's one of the toughest things, but I want you to remain encouraged, because, we can't continue to move the needle. We just got to, be diligent and stay there at the table. Charlene, you wanted to say something? I see you came off mute.
Yeah, it's to Chelsea's point, and thank you, Eric, for such the encouragement. But I think we all know the state in which we are in. We are in Virginia. Virginia has a strong history and for its injustice when it comes to Blacks. To paint a picture, 19% of the state are Blacks, but 57% or so are in prison, right? And, they have astronomical injustices from the inception of their criminal justice system, very systemic. And so to Chelsea's point, when you start talking about the reenactment and we had something good, then that went away. And it did, it went away. And it was almost as if it was an attack on social equity. It was really just, if we want to make this happen, then we have to get rid of XYZ. And it all seemed to point to social equity. And so that is really what's most disturbing about even the changes that the Democrats were willing to kind of sell out in order to get things passed. They added hemp into the game. They tried to up, vertical integration, but yet allow a quick entry for Big Pharma. So I think that even though it failed, it should have failed because it wasn't right.
Right, right. right. You know, and one thing I will say, and I'm hearing Virginia, you guys are not the first state to do this, but New York is also looking at something like this. I caution these states who, and I hope legislators are listening, be very careful in mixing your industrial hemp program with your adult use program. Adult use is still illegal at the federal level, and I'm telling you, you're risking jeopardizing both programs, the industrial hemp program and the adult use program, by doing so. And New York is looking at a model that's like that. And I to some degree, I understand that the logic is like, okay, we want to get, you know, this online as quickly as possible. So let's try to, you know, but I'm telling you, it is going to a place. And then for those of you who have businesses in the hemp space, you want a separate, and I'm not an attorney, but I'm telling you, you want mm-hmm. a separate entity for anything you are going to do on the adult use side. But anyway, I digress. So we'll, yes. Go ahead.
You're absolutely right, Eric. I mean, it's still federally prohibited. And so you walk a very fine line, fine line. And those who were lobbying, the hemp processors that were lobbying, they were prepared. They knew what they were going to do. It was their way in. Yes, the legislators should be very careful because we all have to walk a very fine line within the state laws. And so when you start allowing early entry, first of all, it's a barrier to access for us, right? And second of all, it could definitely be troubling when you start looking at the thin line between the federal and the state there. But Chelsea, you were going to say something?
I just want to, I put it in the chat and I don't want to be messy, but I'm going to really say in 2021, if you're coming to these committee meetings and listening, a lot of hemp advocates, not saying they're the exact same people, but they were quoted saying, we are rope, not dope. And they said they wanted nothing to do with this adult use market. And then this year, when there is an opportunity for larger folks to come in, now there is this chance to say, hey, we're here together. I absolutely agree with Eric. I think it's just a good business sense, but I think it's also an opportunity to just see how quickly narratives and groups and issues can change, as well as when those political landscape changes, right? Just in order for some type of possible power. So it's also important just be watching the actors that are in this cannabis space and their influencers.
Yeah, you know, so one of the questions I want to ask you guys, and we're going to, you know, shift, I want to make sure we get through a lot. We can spend forever talking about that part, that sausage making, right? But I want to talk to you guys about, you know, some of the things that, you know, Charlene raised earlier, and starting with home grow. You know, I will applaud Virginia for including home grow, because I do think, you know, oftentimes that's overlooked as an important component to when we're talking about decriminalization and you know, moving this plant forward and making sure that people who are in communities and Black and brown communities are protected. Now, don't get me wrong, it doesn't go all the way as far as we need it to go. There's still so much more we need to take care of. People who are in public housing, you know, people with kids, you know, protecting employees from employers and stuff. There's so much more, don't get me wrong. But I'm saying as a tool, I think homegrown is a good way of, you know, providing some level of protection for folks in those communities. So give us a quick rundown, because I know people are here on the call are saying, okay, like you said, Charlene, people are asking you, what can I grow? You know, and I know there's so many different nuances you can go down, you know, in terms of, can I do this? Can I do that? But, you know, can you lay out just a general, you know, here's what you're allowed to do, here's what you're not allowed to do as it pertains to home grow.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was going to let Chelsea answer that.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead. You can answer it.
Sure. So I will get the high level of it, but it is, you can grow up to 4 plants in your home. That is not per person. And there is also the caveat of just making sure that if you are renting a home, that it is within your lease, right? Because some landlords, private landlords, are saying that you are not able to have that within your home. And then any type of federally subsidized home, public housing and things, you are still not allowed to have cannabis there or grow there. It is not legal right now to buy seeds, which makes it a bit confusing of where to go with that. There's some giveaway for seeds because there's gifting within that. So that's some gray area within the law. I will also really caution people to make sure that if you are doing home cultivation, that you have it out of reach of folks under age of 21 and you have it properly labeled. It's really important that you review some of the laws and that you have them properly labeled with your government issued ID number also on there. So those are some things just to make sure you don't get in trouble. After, I will just mention that after this past session, there was some concern that I don't want to call misinformation, but I kind of want to call it misinformation from some operators that were not happy about the bill failing, that said because now the bill failed, home cultivation is at risk for people that have like a small infraction than to get a class 6 felony. And so I just want to clear that up really quickly. And what that means is last year when we passed the home cultivation policy, we didn't have actual attachments of penalty to each section that if you did not follow it. And so it all just went to a default of a class 6 felony. That scares a lot of people when you put it out there. What I will say since July 1 and why we work in coalition with lawyers like Charlene and public defenders like Justice for Virginia, they're able to tell us that's not something that's come across their desk at all. These classic felonies, correct. So what that tells me as an organizer, again, is that the police are not in homes checking home grow right now. And if they are, y'all, we know that it's normally, if I can be honest, as a former social worker, more with parents that are having home visits and things like that. So why it's really important to remember to make sure you're doing this safely and where you're living. I know that was a very long answer for the home cultivation piece, but I hope that did give some information. And I've seen some people in the chat as well. So I wanted to also make sure that people are following, and I'm going to look at that and see if I
need. Oh, yeah. And Antoine, if you're getting, I apologize. I have not been popping into the chat. So, I was going to say, if we're getting any questions in the chat, you know, definitely, you know, kind of give me a heads up so that we can, you know, we want to make sure we leave some time for people to ask those questions. Just
everybody, I've been posting exactly from the Virginia website, the actual information. So if you want to know exactly what the deal is and the laws and stuff like that, go to there, find out what it is and read it and make sure that you're doing the right things. And if it's wrong, let's go ahead and fight it.
Yeah, absolutely. Charlene, did you want to add anything on to that in terms of homegrown?
Yeah, and the reason why I bounce that to Chelsea, because I know she's been in this space and she's probably explained that a little more, but I like to tell people, anybody who's asking me, 4 plants, don't share your plants, keep it safe. That's really the long and short of it. Again, if you're living in someone else's property and you don't have much control, you already know anything federal, and I can tell you can go beyond even the home growth. I literally had a client that was working for a property that was on federal property. Well, this was in September. She at home growing her stuff, goes to work, gets injured on federal property. So you have to remember that it's still illegal on a federal basis. So when you start thinking about home growth, think about where you live. Also think about what you do, your job. Yeah. You work for the federal government, things of that sort. So yes.
Those are, I think, excellent, excellent points. Antoine, I am going to bring you in real quick. For those who are people who are considering home grow, and Chelsea and Charlene, you guys feel free to answer this as well. Where can I go find somewhere to learn? Who's in Virginia giving me the knowledge of how to grow this plant at home?
Well, we have several different businesses around here that I know of that I found them on social media, have connected with me, that they're doing it at their shops, at their businesses inside and showing how to grow it itself. So definitely reaching out to someone, making sure that they're doing the right things, but not actually smoking it on the street. And we make sure, doesn't mean that you can go and smoke it on the street, because somebody tried to do that, and that it didn't go right.
Yeah, the laws do still say that public consumption is illegal. Like that's still, you know, not allowed, guys.
Right. Yeah, that's not allowed. So 420 is coming up. Be safe out there. Another place is Grow Empire, Black-owned business. They have some classes and things of that sort that could help you with the grow piece. Oaksterdam University, I saw that just come up across. They have some classes, some horticultural classes that you can take online, and they're based out of California.
Okay, awesome. Chelsea, you got a couple?
Yeah, I would just say, just like Antoine, to follow our pages. We're always trying to share folks that are having classes in the moment. I know that there is Old Town Manchester here in Richmond, Virginia, that has classes as well, Old Manchester. And they're hemp right now, but they also just teaching folks how to grow. And I also share Canoclusive. They're a brand that does a lot of sharing brands and classes as well. So, and particularly if folks are interested, Sativa University, please reach out if you're looking for something specific. We like to connect folks as well.
Awesome. Thank you guys for that. I know that is somebody had that question and didn't ask it, so I wanted to ask it for them. So, you know, move it along. Charlene, you brought up expungements, right? And I know the state has automatic expungements, but, you know, talk about that process, right? You know, I happen to know that just because it's automatic expungement doesn't mean that it's, well, you know, automatic to some degree. There may be some other things that have to happen. So can you take us through that a little bit?
Yes, and actually in Virginia, there's something right now in the legislation. So it's not actually expungement, it's sealing. Okay, so
you're absolutely right, yeah.
Yes, so there's a difference between sealing and expungement. When you seal a record, even though it just kind of makes it hard for someone to get to it, but it'll still remain a public record. Okay, so if it's out there and you know how to get on the court system, you will still be able to access it. So that's one of the issues that I have with all of this, if we're really trying to right the wrong. So sealing is what we now have in place, but expungement would be there's a bill out, and I think I shared it with Rods, it's Senate Bill 742. And what that is looking to do is to automatically seal misdemeanor marijuana offenses. And so, and in doing that, and petition-based certain felony marijuana offenses. And so that will create automatic sealing. It will create basically where a business screening service that will do the work to kind of make it easy, because of course there will be a lot of work. And so that is currently left in courts of justice as of March 8th, 2022. So it's very important when we start talking about these pieces, right? First of all, advocating for the right space, that we kind of understand what's going to happen. So Virginia initially says we're going to seal certain offenses, but these people that are going to come in and going to sell all this marijuana are selling tons, right? And felonies are left out.
On purpose.
That's a problem.
Yeah.
That's a problem. It's a huge problem. If we want to be able to truly allow access, opportunity, and to right the wrong for those communities that have been most affected, felonies have to be included. So I was very pleased, although it hasn't gone anywhere, to see Senate Bill 742, which is a more push than what we currently have, which is a seal. And that seal is for misdemeanor, very lightweight stuff. And then another thing that's been what I like to call a scutterbug, when you start talking about sealing and then you start talking about social equity, well, if it's automatically sealed, and the person wants to use a social equity piece to get it, now he upside down, right?
We had that same conversation in New Jersey. I think it's another one of those instances where you know, the policy isn't well thought out in terms of how it will actually be implemented, right? Because you're right. If, you know, what then does that person use to prove that they are social equity? You know, for New Jersey, they do have the based on area code. So if you're in that income area, you could still also qualify. But for those individuals who have that highest level of threshold for social equity, meaning they themselves have been arrested, you're right. If their records were expunged, you know, how do they, you know, then prove that?
Right. So those are the challenges. They haven't gotten it quite right. Felons need to be included in the conversation. I know personally people that, and not just on the expungement side, on the opportunity side as well. And I've been in rooms with Republicans, and they've repeated to me 100 times, well, felons not going to be able to do it. Felons, 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 felons. Well, what about felons? Right? Yeah. What about this whole system that you're going to come in and you're going to sell more weight than any of these felons may have? And you're going to have economic opportunity that these felons are going to be disadvantaged from. And that's a serious and significant issue that we're just kind of not even, they don't want to address it, but it has to be addressed in the legislation in order for us to truly, truly, truly apply what everybody's saying is social equity. We want to be equitable. We want to get this right.
Can I
bring up? Go ahead, Chelsea.
Yeah, also, I dropped in the chat because we actually organized a rally with the Expungement Council. It's groups all over Virginia that's been fighting for Senate Bill 742. And that particularly as all the negotiations happened, it got gutted a lot, but we were really still looking to lift that lifetime ban. As of right now, you can only seal all your records, y'all. And it's just really a big barrier for folks. But since we're talking about people with felonies, I really wanted to also bring up the resentencing matter that was brought up this session as well. And what many people don't know, as we are talking about people with felonies, the legislators make it very clear they will never provide access or opportunity or way with anyone that has violent, quote unquote, felonies with their records. Right. And we have to understand that Virginia was in the top three of list of violent offenses that someone could get. Right. We're in Virginia. We're in the South. And so just as an example, our resentencing bill, which was SB 745, said that if you had a felony marijuana conviction, you had to go in front of the parole board only if that felony, only if you did not have any nonviolent felonies. It's leaning late, but you cannot have a quote unquote violent felony if you wanted to be considered for resentencing, even if it had nothing to do with your marijuana crime, right? So say you had a marijuana offense, say you just happen to have a quote unquote violent offense as well, you're disqualified. And so that's the type of thing that I just also want to talk about when we're saying felonies and nonviolent.
Yeah, you know what, what's the craziest part about it? And again, Virginia, you know, I don't know if this is, you know, hope or, you know, or what to call it, but y'all are not the only ones. I mean, that what we're talking about right now literally happens in pretty much every state. It's happened at the federal level, even with hemp, which is legal. This is an ongoing conversation. I don't have a good answer for it. You know, I think, you know, there's fear obviously there and that's what we're working to overcome. But I think it's the silliest thing ever, because in reality, when we think about, the legacy market, well, hell, if you was, you know, selling marijuana back then and you didn't have a gun, then you didn't love your life. You know what I mean? Like you didn't. And so if you got arrested while doing so, the likelihood that you also had a weapon on you, We're not really comparing anything. And so what we're really saying is that, you know, if you were selling back then, we don't want you in here or not. We're going to overlook how dangerous it was for you to do that during that time. And most of these charges are tacked on, and the marijuana charge is the sticking point for them. And they add in all these other things like the gun charge, like, you know, any of those resisting arrests, any of that. And then it becomes a violent charge. And now you fall into that bucket that we're talking about right now. So, but you know, like I said, I don't know what that answer is. I just know we have to keep having that conversation. We have to keep, you know, I think one thing it does help me think about is that, you know, as an industry as a whole, cannabis advocates, we have kind of, we've missed the ball a little bit because we focus so much on cannabis specific policies that we forget the pervasiveness of the war on drugs and how we have to be looking at criminal justice reform at the same time. We have to be looking at other, you know, areas all at the same time simultaneously and looking to see how we impact those policies as well, because they do have an impact in this industry down the line. So, you know, it's just one of those things, but I know we're going to be, you know, running out of time here shortly. So I wanted to get to the last thing, the licensing part, right? This is really the crux of when we talk about making this industry diverse, when we talk about social equity, you know, across the board, we've talked about licensing, right? And I've also, and I'll go on board and I'll preface this part of the conversation with this. I think, again, as advocates, we've missed the boat because we focus too heavily on just the licensing, that we don't recognize, again, how pervasive this war on drugs was and how we need to be looking at policies in so many other areas as well. But Chelsea, Charlene, Antoine, how do we make Virginia's adult use program equitable and fair? How do we do that? And I know that's a loaded question, but it's purposeful. You know, again, I want you to be encouraging here. I want you to let these people know who are on this call, you know, that there is hope. You know, we've already laid out that this is a rough battle. You know, there's nothing easy about it, but how do we do it? How do we get these people on the call activated to help us in this fight?
You know, I just want to say I'm an organizer first. And so I think that it's just finding a way for everyone to tap into what attracts you to cannabis. And there is a space for you. And then start asking the questions and allow us to be able to feed you this information and show up to these conversations right now. And I know we're going to get into the particulars a little bit, but I just wanted to jump in really fast and just say this is organizing. Right. And so I think, remember, it doesn't have to just be on you. We are all here to really support and to get us out there. So I just wanted to jump in and say organizing really fast.
Awesome. Awesome. Go ahead.
That's a loaded question. But, you know, just to keep it short, simple, you know, you talk about the war on drugs, right? You talk about a war on our people that has existed since 1863. Okay, so in 1863, it was 0.5% of Blacks on the overall wealth of our nation. You take that same overall population, and today they say it ranges between 1.5 to 4.4%. We haven't gotten anywhere. So the war on drugs is not only just the war on drugs, it's the war on people. So we need no more criminal statutes, nothing more to bring us back to the war on drugs or any of that outdated vision. We need expungement. We need profit participation. We need social equity support to remain where it is. We need tax reinvestment for those communities that have been affected by these drugs. We need those communities identified specifically, established systems, education. Those are just some of the things that we need. Some of it was in the initial bill and still remains out there to be reenacted, but more needs to be done. And then, of course, we need everybody, all right? It is going to take, as you had mentioned, Eric, it's definitely not a sprint. It's going to be a marathon. You know, anybody who knows any type of legal system or knows anything about Virginia, we're not just going to get our way. But we got to keep the pressure on, and we got to identify what needs to be done, and then inch by inch, piece by piece, get it done. So it's going to take the long haul to get it done, in my opinion.
Yeah, I'm say the long haul and coming together, just like Chelsea said, and trying, just like you said, for my part, definitely everybody in here who, if you know me from Virginia, you know I'm a part of numerous organizations. I'm all about leadership. I'm all about let's go ahead and move forward. I'm a part of the NAACP, the Urban League, Black Lives Matters, the Black Chamber of Commerce. I go to a Black church. I graduated from an HBCU. Look, let's go ahead and make sure we have our groups together and we go ahead and do it Black. I'm just saying, you know, the charge could be in the streets, but the charge got to be inside the office too. We got to put litigation together, policies and procedures together, create those bills, have those legislators on our sides and have them having our backs. Chelsea has done great things with letters and organizations and coming together. Let's go ahead and make sure we become part of those groups. When we say that we need your help, we need you to go ahead and call this senator, this representative. That's what we need. When we say we need you to send a letter to this person, this is what we need. We need you to take charge, follow our guidelines, but then if you want to be a leader, step up with us and lead with us.
You know, Antoine, you're reminding me, and again, Virginia being in the South, and I'm a student of the Civil Rights Movement, there were tons of organizations that were there helping to organize our communities. But more importantly, the community was engaged. The community was engaged. And so I'm saying that to you all because we need y'all to be engaged. I think we have some really good organizations, you know, across this country and in Virginia, who are really fighting for us and who are there, who are committed to showing up, being in these, you know, meetings behind closed doors, being that voice for you all. But we need you all engaged so that when it comes time for y'all to help us turn up the heat and apply pressure, that we're not walking in there alone. We're walking in there, you know, as a unified body. So, you know, let's talk about, so the licensing, right, is there. You know, we know we're going to have some structure, and that's still being parsed out right now. The bill is there, and that's going to go through. What do we need? Do we think that bill is going to go through at all from a licensing standpoint, or do we think we're going to have a completely new bill at some point that really, you know, gets us? I know we started with one bill that went away. We got a new bill, you know, but where are we at with licensing?
Yeah, I think that I have you know, done the poking some holes and had some conversations since they gaveled out. Session is officially over. They are going to have a special session to discuss the budget. So as of right now, there is no, that like you mentioned, the bill was continued. And so what we do predict after speaking to some legislators that they are feeling right now, y'all, that they might not have to bring back these social equity components. They're telling us that after they did not get reenacted this time, then maybe they don't need to bring them back up in this next bill, because now, again, it's a different leadership that's conservative. And when I say we could not say the word equity in the House, the legislators literally told us in the House, delegates, don't say the word equity. So Eric, the answer to your question is, I predict that there will be a whole new bill that they're saying is continued, but it'll just be stripped of even more of what we need. And why right now we have to be on the offense and organize even more than the last couple of years where we've been on the defense. Just to I wanted to give a piece of information that people may or may not know. Prior to the 2021 session where we did pass a bill, our coalition put together a resolution to create a study in the session prior to that looked at cannabis industries across the nation. It was a JLARC study. And so that was an offensive move, right? To say, you can't ignore this information in front of you. And that's how we got a lot of those social equity pieces in. They attempted to just do a work group that was with other organizations and no actual looking at other states. And that was very strategic on their part. And we had to band together, make a lot of noise with not even a lot of resources. And we were able to get that study done. So we're kind of at the same place, Eric, now of what are we about to present in front of the legislators to say, this is what we want, and not wait for them to say, this is what you get.
Yeah. I mean, likelihood of this getting brought up in special session, very unlikely, right?
Very unlikely. It's just for the budget. That's what the special session, and they've told us that the conferees, which are the people that are chosen just to make a negotiation, are going to handle it all out, and the legislators will basically just come back to vote and be back.
To vote. Okay. And so I asked that question, guys, because I want to help paint a picture of what we're looking at, right? So now we have the rest of this year to really gear up for the next legislative session, making sure that we, one, develop the language that we would like to see that is, you know, aligned with what we've been talking about here tonight, and that we're developing those partners and coalition in the legislature to try to get this moved. It's not going to be an easy fight. It's going to be an uphill battle, and we're going to need Republicans. And so we're going to need you guys to support us, to call your legislator for your district, to email them, and so on. So definitely stay tuned to Marijuana Justice, to InfraMM, so that we give you guys all of that. So now let's move on to some other things. Again, I know we're coming up on time, but I want to get through a lot tonight. We talked about licensing, right? I have always advocated that we, as much as I love Black and Brown people, we unfortunately just will not be able to start enough businesses. Enough of us are not going to get licensed in order to call this industry diverse, right? It's just not gonna happen. The way that we make this industry diverse then is by two other ways. One, employment, meaning that we need to be integrated fully into all of these organizations, you know, whether they're small businesses or multi-state operators, right? We need to be there from C-suite on down, right? And then we also need to make sure that we are getting into the ancillary space. We have to get into the ancillary space. There's so much opportunity. And so I wanna ask you guys to touch on that. What are your thoughts about, you know, someone who says, okay, you know what? I really wasn't even thinking about the dispensary or the grow. What can I do from an ancillary standpoint to get into this industry? And what should I be doing right now to position?
Well, number one, you have to know about business. So I just wanna say that for everyone, that all of these things are businesses, okay? So the same business steps apply here. These ancillary businesses, y'all, when people talk about plant touching, I remind them everything that else that you need to touch besides the plant needs to be from a Black business. And that's how you can think of ideas of what do people need to grow in this plant and how can you bring that to the table to fill a gap. And so I really love being able to facilitate those conversations and be able to get people in touch with other folks to say, hey, number one, do I need business, you know, a little bit of business mentoring? Number two, do I need to be around people that work in the plant business just to see my ideas? And number three, am I going to some of these virtual conferences and talks where people are having these conversations, right? There's so much knowledge to be done, but I think that is where the moneymaker is. And I'm all and what you touched on, Eric, just a second ago about the federal legalization and the future of that. If you are an ancillary business, then you probably that's not going to harm you as much as trying to get one of these state licenses, right? So that's, again, long-term sustainability.
Yeah, and when you're a non-touching plant business, ancillary, you are subject to regular business taxes versus 280E, which is a cannabis use tax. So it has its preferences from a business perspective. I will echo what Eric has said as well. Getting into ancillary, it's almost anything if you can think of it. Going to conferences, whether it's virtual or actually attending conferences, is always good. You'll get to meet other people in the cannabis space. It is a very interesting space. It is a very tight-knit space. And they want you. And when I say you, they want Black businesses in this space. I've heard it from top to down. Okay. So get into it. Figure out what your niche is. You like to market. You're good at keeping accounting or books. You know, Lot Green is a good ancillary business, one that's going to support the industry. So think ancillary, think of support. If you can think of it, it's there and you just got to get into it. And I would definitely encourage just getting involved with some of the conferences and getting your boots to the ground, because that's how you're going to learn and maybe find something that you like to do in it.
Yeah. And I definitely got to do a quick plug for InfraMM's program, our InfraCure program, which is all about supplier diversity. Make sure y'all go to InfraCure.org. Somebody's going to drop that in the chat, I know. And you can sign your business up. You know, we are connected to multi-state operators and cannabis businesses around the country who are looking to connect with Black and minority-owned businesses. They tell me all the time, and I'll tell you a little story. I just this week, I was consulting a client of mine, and he's in the CBD space, and he got CBD products, and he's so fed up because he can't get his products moved, he can't get distribution. And he shared with me a conversation he had with somebody who was the procurement officer for a dispensary. And he was like, listen, I just need, 12 by 24 inch space on your shelf for my products. That's all I need. And the guy turned around and asked him, do you sell paper clips? And the guy was like, and my client was so pissed and upset, but he missed what the guy was trying to tell him. I have no space for your CBD products, but if you sell paper clips, invoice me tomorrow. You understand what I'm saying? So I want y'all to really think about this. Again, I said it a little bit in jest, but I did it on purpose because I want y'all to understand everything you can think of that any other business would need, a cannabis business needs, from cleaning services to lawn care to accounting and legal services, PPE equipment, cleaning equipment, things for just stocking the office, IT personnel, all of these different things. I'm telling you guys, call centers, you know what I mean? All of these different things are things that these businesses will need. And if you can position yourself in that space, you can get contracts, I think, fairly easy. The other thing to think about is become a middleman. So even if you're saying to me, Eric, well, I don't sell cleaning supplies, or I don't have a cleaning business. Well, can you find someone that you could partner with that does? And then let them do the cleaning supplies. They know the operations of that. And you go out and get business in the space. I don't know, just an idea. But all I'm saying is there's so many different ways for us to skin this cat, so many different ways for us to get into this industry. We got to get into, we got to think outside of the box. All right. So we had somebody ask about, and I'm getting some of these questions fed to me. So we're getting into some of the questions from the chat right now. Somebody asked about how to get your MMJ card. I think that was answered already. So we'll go ahead and move to the next one after that. What can people do to get involved and participate? And we're definitely going to drop, I think information to InfraMM's membership, to Marijuana Justice and so on. But, not from an organizational standpoint, what can they be doing if they're sitting at home and they're saying, I want to get in, I want to help move this needle, I want to be a part of this fight? What could they be doing?
Well, I know one thing right now that everyone can do is that you can sign our petition. So we have come together to really put together some language of, the nitty gritty or the things that we really need from this bill. And so we're excited to drop this. I'm rambling a little bit while I get the link, and I'm going to put it right here in the chat. So please sign this petition. You can do it right now at home. And then you can also join us next month, April 6th at Marijuana Justice. We have our monthly meetings every first Wednesday at 6:30 on Zoom, and you can come and talk more. We're actually going to have our full Canna Justice Coalition there, and they're going to be talking about the different criminal justice pieces. I really appreciate what Eric said earlier, because we have to focus on the criminal justice pieces. And to be very honest, that's our background. So we entered this with a fight for a war on drugs. And so now we're partnering with folks like InfraMM to really make sure these business components and that we are involved in a legal space. So I just want to make sure that everyone is going to sign our petition and join this movement that we have going on and just really building momentum with.
420, Chelsea.
Well, 420. Yeah. Right now I think that 420 is on a Wednesday. I'm going to lift, I know what you're talking about right now, but I think that right now I want to just lift, Marijuana Justice is actually going to be over at the National Cannabis Festival that Saturday, doing a couple of, panels. We'll be on a panel about prohibition in the South, as well as cannabis, legalization and prison abolition. And so we'll be doing a lot of things there. There's a lot of things happening for 420. It's like our special holiday time. It's holiday season now coming up.
Absolutely. But I want everybody, don't just go and sign the petition. Go sign it and then send it to 20 other people to get them to sign it as well. This is the, when you ask, what can you do? This is the type of stuff that we need. We need you to amplify the work that we are doing. Help us to reach hundreds more people by, you know, sharing it on your social media, sharing it with your network, okay?
Part of Minorities for Medical Marijuana in Virginia, we're gonna be starting a whole new Facebook group tomorrow. It's gonna be open Facebook group, and we're gonna be sharing the petition in there, and we'll be where you can share it on your other platforms. We're gonna be looking at marijuana justice and sharing their information in there. We're gonna bring other organizations so they can share their information in there so that we can come together and collaborate and learn. Because this plan is out here. This plant is out here. We have to advocate. We have to come together and make sure we have the right information and the right organizations to connect with.
Yeah. And you know something else that you guys can do, you know, for us, as you listen to these type of conversations, take them back to your family. Go have talks with your extended, with your immediate family and your extended family. Have these conversations. Because too often we are having these conversations, but it's in a silo, and in the rest of the community, you know, this information isn't trickling down. So again, that's something else that you can do to help us amplify our message, and then also have these conversations in your own homes. Talk to your families about what they're hearing. Clear up some of the misinformation that is out there, because you guys are getting that information. Okay. We had another question about legislative language. I think we kind of touched on this a little bit, but I'll bring it back up and let you guys respond. What legislative language do you need to help support the movement?
If that's somebody out here offering some policy support, then I say drop in your email and we'll get back to you. I think that's it. But if you look at our petition, that's really some of our main priorities right there. I just say if that's someone's offering some help, we'll always take it.
Absolutely. And InfraMM has been working on, hopefully it should be coming out sooner than later. It's been in the works for a while, but we're working on both our federal and our state policy positions and recommendations to share with people. And I think that's going to have some pretty good language in there, some stuff that we haven't seen across the country, as well as piggybacking on that. And that leads me to the next question of what states, in your opinion, have gotten this whole social equity thing right? You know, are there good models out there that we should be looking at for Virginia? Or either, I'll give you the flip side of that question. Are there some places that we should be looking at and say, we absolutely don't want whatever they have?
We don't want Illinois.
We love y'all, Illinois. We do. We do.
You know, I mean, there's so much. I mean, that's such a loaded question. Even in places like California, I spoke to a cannabis owner a couple weeks ago. And they're waiting, like the applicants are waiting like 2 years. They're spending money and renting space and real estate, and you know, things are slow. Or if they get like a social equity license, they're treated differently. So I don't, you know, from what I've seen, I don't know if anyone could be the model state for us to go and be like. I think that's why the petition that we're focused on now talks about transformative legislation. We're trying to transform this. We know what we're dealing with. We know where we are. We've seen it. We have enough background and research now, you know, from JLARC and just knowing what the other states have done, what's good, what's not good, to understand what we need is truly transformative. But I do know we don't want Illinois. We don't want to be targeted. We want more inclusion.
Yeah, I don't want to name a place because then they change it, or you know, I hear other rumors of things from actual people there. So I try not to mention that, but I always say, look, we have to have ahead of the game applications. We have to have some kind of seed money that's not loans, it's not going to go to collections. And we have to have different areas to tap in at different levels, right? That's just access. That's all we're really creating here is access day one, and not to get played like we've seen other states. And I think the question that people ask about, well, what's the equity model? what I would rather us start asking is, what is the playbook by our big corporations that keeps working in each state? Let's identify that. And how do we then combat it? Because they're doing the same thing at each state to try and hold up equity and create unconstitutional things and things in court. And we just have to learn from each other and learn from our mistakes, I think.
Yeah. You know, one thing I always say about social equity, because we get that question all the time. So who has done it right? And I always say that we have seen a ton of great legislative language, right? Like the language has been really, really good. Where we always seem to fall short is in implementation. It's just, that is where we are continuously seeing that even really good legislation gets completely muddied, and what was intended is not the outcome. And so, like you said, nobody has gotten it right. So we still have a lot to do in that regard, still a lot of work in getting it right. Maybe Virginia can be that, but I think in order for Virginia to be that, we got to really, you know, like you said, pay attention to how we can expect multi-state operators to show up. But, you know, they aren't the only bad actors. There's other people who get in and see opportunities and get in. I think we really have to look at the implementation part, which is why we also have to get beyond in our advocacy work. It has to go beyond just the legislator. And we have to get into, the administrative agencies and during the rulemaking process as well, because that's where the rubber really hits the road. And that's where we tend to see, again, the ball gets dropped quite often. Antoine, you wanted to say something?
Yeah. So, Eric, along with that process and where we're at right now, too, and Chelsea can explain it a little bit more, too, timing and barriers to the social equity, because we have businesses out there that want to do it. And so, and the timing right now, when we're saying they tried to push all these big corporations out there before we can get the small businesses, and the small businesses don't even have the licenses, the funding, the, you know, all those different things in place for social equity. But when you push all these big businesses into the market, they'll saturate the market and spill all the business out of there. So it is a conflict of interest when they want to actually put big business first before they actually bring on the smaller companies or even allow the license to go through and all the different loops to go through those.
But you know, Antoine, even if we protect against big business, and I'm on record saying this oftentimes, we can't avoid big business. They are coming, they're gonna be here, they're gonna find a way in. That ain't something we can really avoid. We definitely have to protect small businesses, I think. But even in that protection of small businesses, it's not just the big multi-state operators we got to go against. I'm telling you this because I'm doing some work in a neighboring state to you all, working with social equity people, and I'm in the room in these conversations, and there is a mentality that exists when people come into cannabis and they come from other industries with money, they come from, you know, and the way that they approach it is just very different. And so I think, you know, when we talk about policies that have to be on books, we have to make sure that there are policies that protect against predatory partnership deals and so on. We have to make sure that when we talk about, you know, social equity applicants, that they're getting that 51% equity ownership and it's outright non-contingent. You know, so we're not talking about on paper, it looks like 51%, but then there's some operating deal on the back end and but these are the types of things that, like you said, we have been learning from other states. We have been, you know, studying what has happened. And I think that's going to be reflective in our, recommendations that we put out for policy as well. We got a couple more questions before we start to wrap up a little bit. Somebody wanted to know, how often do we plan to do these? I know it's been a little while since we did this before, but I definitely think that, as we look at what the roadmap is for us before next session, that we certainly need to have these a little bit more regularly. So I don't have an answer. I know Chelsea probably doesn't have an answer. I know both of our organizations are constantly doing stuff. But I think between Antoine and Chelsea, we'll come together and we'll have something that is a little bit more regular so you guys can come get updated, weigh in on the process, and continuously, get those marching orders, if you will. Fair enough. All right. Another question we have. Okay, this is basically, before we wrap up, somebody asked a little explanation of Illinois. Both of you guys said you don't want Illinois. Can you talk about what you saw in Illinois, and then we'll wrap up and kind of go through our closing. But what in particular, what in Illinois did you, not like, or that you definitely don't want to be replicated in Virginia?
Well, Illinois did a lottery. This is mafia and backwards. And I actually heard of a group, a couple people from this area that tried to go in and buy their way in, and gathered about $70 million and still couldn't get in. So when I talk about Illinois, I'm talking about opportunity. And anything that I talk about in this space, whether it be, we're talking about the social equity, the applicants who want to come in, or you talk about the people that have been affected, it's about opportunity. And so I think they stripped that, they made it very, very difficult for anyone to really get into space. They didn't consider anything, in my opinion, as it relates to social equity. And we all know what Chicago, and we've all heard about the crime rates and how distressed the community is and things of that sort. So it was pretty unjust if I had to name anybody. And I've heard Illinois, not from just us, I've heard Illinois from people that don't look like us, as not being any type of model for this industry.
So I want to definitely chime in here. So I will give some props to Illinois that they have a reinvestment fund. Okay. And so the R3, it might not be perfect, but it is giving an opportunity for advocates in Illinois to try and get their hands on that money, because it's there, it's coming in. What I don't like about Illinois, and I'm like, nah, we don't need to do Illinois, and why I know Virginia is watching Illinois, the little technical piece, I'm a policy person. So there was a piece in the language that said you could qualify for social equity if you just hired 10 people that qualified for social equity. You as a business owner didn't have to, and that's why Eric is mentioning this. Well, y'all, Virginia in its first round in 2021, guess what that language was? It was right in the Virginia bill, and we had to make all the noise, and they were like, what do you mean? This should be fine. This is industry standard. And we had to go back. I had to find Illinois people that had just found this and tell folks that they had not one Black African American owned dispensary in Illinois, and they were supposed to be the beacon. So I just want to say that they did do the fund, but what they didn't do is that intent and that implementation that Eric was talking about. The lottery is a terrible idea, definitely here for that. And since we have a cap in Virginia, we just know they're going to cap it. We have to be really intentional with how we're included with that limited number.
Absolutely. Yeah, Illinois, there was a lot that they left to be desired in their implementation. I did see that. That was the first state I saw that 10 employee rule would qualify you as social equity. And I'll tell you, that led to a lot of predatory people coming in and just gathering up 10 people to put on with no intention of, really giving them any serious, employee benefits or any, even keeping them on long term. They did it to get the license, and then, it's a move on thing. So, but anyway, those are all the types of things that we have to be careful and diligent about to make sure that Virginia, doesn't go down that path. But you too will have your own set of issues, and we will need you all to be right there with us in lockstep to fight to make sure that we continue to shape this industry to make sure it's fair and equitable for us. Well, as we wrap up, for tonight, I want to give thank each of our panelists, for being here with us tonight and just sharing so much insight and information. I know it was a lot. I hope y'all were taking notes. I know it's out there on Facebook for you guys to go back and watch again. There was tons in here, but get engaged, folks. Get engaged and stay engaged, because we need you all. So we'll go back. Let's start with Antoine. Any last words for that you want to leave with the audience tonight? Any lasting thoughts?
All I say is basically, if you're here in Virginia, you want to get connected, I'm definitely one to help connect you. I may not have all the knowledge, but definitely Chelsea, Charlene is out here. We got numerous people out there. I'm going to be sharing stuff on social media, showing, sharing it on my page. If you want to step up and be a part of what we're doing with InfoMMM, go ahead, find the website, find me, talk to Roz, talk to Eric. We want to do stuff together. I'm all about collaborating. If you want to do your own silo thing, do your own thing. But if you want to come together and make a bigger impact, let's do this together.
Nice, nice. Thank you, brother. And again, I just love your energy. If y'all ain't, I mean, like I'm feeling the goosebumps on my arms. If y'all don't get energized by that, I don't know what else we could do to energize y'all. So Chelsea, go ahead.
Look, I was just saying, I want to keep like a little Antoine in my pocket just to keep it open during the day. Yeah, last words is just stay involved. Please ask all of the questions. I get stumped a lot and it actually leads me to find out more information for us, right? And just please, if you can register for the April 6th Marijuana Monthlies. If you're following on social media, we are THC Justice Now is our handles on all social media platforms. We're back on April 6th. And yeah, just let's show up and organize.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you so much again to Marijuana Justice and the whole team. Again, you guys have been awesome partners for us there in Virginia. And, you know, you're just awesome knowledge and a wealth of knowledge and resource for the community. So we appreciate you and look forward to working with you, you know, continuing to work with you in the future as well.
And I just want to shout out one of my colleagues that is in here and that's been helping out, dropping in notes, Evan Smith. That's part of our team. Thanks so much, Evan, for being around.
That's what's up. Thanks, Evan. We appreciate you, brother. Charlene, go ahead.
Well, I will echo what Antoine said. Together we can. And this is, Rome wasn't built in one day. Virginia didn't get here overnight. We have to do this together. We will have to go across the aisles to get things done. If we want to get this done, we have to do it in numbers. So join these two wonderful organizations, sign the petition, get involved, shoot me an email. You can go to my website, www.mooringlaw, shoot me an email, sign up for the newsletter, look at the YouTube page, Facebook group, do it all. It's going to take all of that to get us what we need. And thank you for allowing me to be a panelist tonight.
Thank you all. You guys were amazing. I hope you guys took something away from this. Thank you to the audience for staying with us, for being here. You know, I know it's late. I know y'all been working all day and it's a long day, but we appreciate you taking out the time to invest in yourself, invest in your community. We need you guys, and we'll see you guys again. Again, stay connected to both organizations, Marijuana Justice and InfoMMM, so you can stay informed of what's going on in the state of Virginia and when the next time we'll have another town hall. All right. Thank y'all again, man. We appreciate y'all. We love y'all. Until the next time, y'all take care of yourselves, man, and stay safe out there.